A couple of times I got the question how to filter a collection view, so in this video we're going to see just that, how to filter a collection view, or rather, how to filter an observable collection. So on the left, we can see running Visual Studio for Mac 2019. We can see the XAML page that comes out of the box whenever you do a File New Xamarin Forms application. You will get the page that you can see on the right running on the iOS simulator. Of course, everything that I show you today is just pure forms. So you can also do this on Android. You can do this on Windows with Visual Studio there if you want to. But you know, I just prefer Mac and it runs best with iOS. So I have that set up, but it should work with other things as well. Let me show you a little trick with Hot Reload. If you've seen other episodes, then you already know what I'm going to do. Update the title and let's call it Filtering Collection View Sample. Here we go. And whenever I save that, you can see with Hot Reload, it automatically updates in your simulator, emulator, or on your physical device. So that is pretty, pretty cool. Now, I don't need all these labels, so I'm just going to implement a little bit of a UI here. And we will also have to add a little bit of the code behind, so I'm going to stop running in a little bit. But let's first see if we can get that UI up and running. The first thing I'm going to add is a search bar. You can do this with an entry or any other control if you want to use something else to actually search or filter your collection view. This also works, by the way, for a list view, mostly the same, because we're actually going to filter like the item source that's behind it and not so much something with the collection view or the list view. But I'm going to use this for a search bar because, you know, a search bar is something that you use to search. And what we're going to do here is actually do the text change event. So here we go, let's generate that one. And of course there is a better, there is a MVVM way to handle this as well. I'm going to show you now with this event right here. If you want to do it in a more MVVM way and you can figure it out, please let me know in the comments, then I'll be happy to make a MVVM video on this as well. But for now, I'm going to do this with the text change just to keep it as simple as possible. And underneath that, let's add an extra return here. I'm going to add the collection view. And actually, let's close this one. There we go. And I'm going to add a little collection view item template. Item template, there we go. And if you want to know more about item templates, I have a video for that. It should pop up on your screen right now. But this basically applies a template to every item that's going to be in our collection. So we have to specify a data template here. And what I'm just going to do is show it in a label. And the text is going to be binding dot. Again, if you want to know about binding and all kinds of stuff, I'll link another video or playlist here. You can also find it in the video description. But what this does basically is it binds to the dot, so to the actual value itself for each item in the collection that we're going to wire up to this collection view. It will hopefully all become clear in a little bit. And let's actually do this horizontal text alignment. Let's do it center. There we go. And now it should show up all nicely in a label. Now the last thing I want to do is actually get some items in my collection view. So let's do, items source. And I'm going to do binding again. So you can just give this collection view a name and set the item source to that if that's what you want. So this is kind of now a mix with MVVM and not MVVM, but I'm going to use it like this. And let's call this my item. So let's save this and see what it does. You can only see the search bar here because the collection view doesn't have any items yet. So let's actually fix that. So I'm going to go to the code behind. I have it open here already, but else go to your solution explorer, find your main page, open it and go to your main page XAML.cs. Here we go. And we can see that our search bar text change event has already been generated. Let's clean this up a little bit because this using the Xamarin Forms one is already here. And this can just be a object like this. Okay, there we go. Now the first thing I want to do is create some kind of source collection. So let's do private read-only. It can be read-only. It can be a string array. Let's call it source items. Is new, there we go, and now I can just throw some random things in here, like subscribe. Maybe you want to subscribe to something, subscribe. Maybe you want to, you know, subscribe to a certain YouTube channel. I don't know, something like that. Well, typing is not going great today. And, you know, something with monkeys, something with Gerald. And I'm going to add this one, subscribed yet. Just to have subscribe in there two times so you can see how this filters with, you know, multiple things that can come up in the results. So, okay, we've got this one. And now, because this is a private one, so I can't use this one as my item source. Well, you can if you, you know, just pointed your collection view in there, but I used the binding route. So then I have to do public. And I'm going to use an observable collection. Observable collection, so it's not in the default things here, and I'm going to make that string. So let's do using system collections object model. Here we go. And I'm going to finish this, and then I'll tell you, I call it my items. I'm going to tell you what is going on here. Here we go. So the observable collection is basically just another array. And you have to specify the type here. So in this case, it's going to be strings, but it can also be complex objects. It doesn't matter. But what the observable collection does, it will automatically notify the UI whenever changes happen. So whenever an item is removed or an item is added, it will notify the UI. And in this case, the collection view, and the collection view will update automatically. So that makes it really easy for us to use this. Now, the thing that you want to remember is whenever you initialize the collection view and you work with this binding stuff, then you never want to create a new instance. You also always want to do myItems.clear and then iterate over the items to add them, because that is the only way all the events are fired, like, hey, items are added or removed or whatever. And whenever you create a myItems is new observable collection, blah, 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 then that connection is lost and your UI will not update again. So pro tip, don't do that. You'll see me doing that, and now you know why. So I'm going to first create it with my items. Here we go. My items is new observable collection. So this is the only place where I'm going to do it, actually. And I'm going to initialize it with source items. So you can put a collection in here. Let's see with the IntelliSense here. You can put in a IEnumerable string, and it will just take all the items from that collection and put it in this observable collection. So we're going to do that. And the other thing, of course, we need to do is set the binding context, in this case, to this. So what's going to happen now for main page, the binding context is this. So that's this whole class, basically. Because now in our XAML, if we go to our XAML, the collection view item source and this binding my items, it now knows to look for my items, a property my items, in whatever is set in my binding context. And that is, again, this main page. So it's going to look in this main page for a property called my items, and here it is. And then it's going to use that as the item source for the collection view. So I hope that is clear. Again, on my channel, there's more videos on these binding stuff and MVVM stuff, because it's hard to get your head around the first time. But just, you know, keep practicing and you will get there. So my items now is the same as the source item. So here we go. So let's implement our code for the search bar text change. So whenever the text change here in our search bar, we are going to, you know, update the results in our collection view. So let's start with that. The first thing I'm going to do is, whoops, format this nicely. That's what I'm going to do, is create a new variable, search term, because what can happen is whenever you cancel the search here, you have a cancel button or that little cross to clear the search term. This can come up as null, as a null value. So before we, you know, have that situation and we have all kinds of exceptions, we want to check that. And so we're going to do that if string is null or whitespace, search term, then I'm going to set the search term to a string.empty. Why I do this is because This way we can just follow the rest of the code that's coming after this. Instead of having to duplicate code for the two paths that we're creating here, it will become clear in a little bit. So after this, I'm going to say search term is search term dot to lower invariant. Here we go. Invariant, however you want to say it. Because this makes the search basically, well, at least one part of it makes it case insensitive. So you don't have to worry about writing the right casing. So upper letters, lower letters. That's probably what you want to do mostly. If not, you know, you can just skip this part. But that's what I want to do. And what I'm going to do then is create another variable with the filtered items. And that is going to be our source items. So I have to hang on to the source items because that's always the collection that I'm going to filter, right? And the my items is going to be the collection that I show. So whenever I start filtering the my items and I only use that as my source of truth, then all the items will be removed and suddenly you can only search between the results of the previous search. Does that make sense? So you always want to hang on to that source master collection, but you know, in a real life scenario, that is probably some collection that's coming from a server or a backend or something like that. So, you know, in my case, it's a static collection right here, array right here, but normally you would get that probably from a backend or whatever. Then it's still a good idea to cache it locally, but you know, you get the point. Our source items, and we're going to say where value. So value is going to be the input. So it's going to iterate through all the source items in here and it's going to put each value in this value parameter that I say here right now. And I'm going to say value dot, again, lower invariant contains. And then I'm going to say our search term. So again, this is a little bit about how you want to create your search logic, because what I'm doing here is I'm taking each item for the source items in via value, and then I'm going to compare that value. I'm going to make it lowercase, and I'm going to see if that contains my search term, so whatever I'm putting in here. And then I'm transforming the whole thing to a list, you know, just to make it easier to compare in a little bit. But you know, you can also say like start with. Maybe you want to only have your search term at the start of the search thing, or ends with, or do whatever. So this I just take contain. So whenever my search term is anywhere in any of the values in my collection view, then it should show up. And now what I'm going to do is actually I'm going to say another thing is if string is null or empty or null or white space, search term again, then I'm going to just say, okay, my filtered items is going to be source items. So this can probably, and then I have to do source items dot to list, of course, it also has to be a list. So there's probably more elegant ways to do this, but why I'm doing this is because whenever the search term is null or empty, we just want to go back and show the whole list, right? So whenever our search term is empty, then I'm just going to put the whole search items back in there. Actually, now that I'm talking about this, it might be that because this is, I create this as a empty string here, that this where will always result in true and it will add all the source items in here anyway. So let's check that in a little bit, but let me first finish this little thing right here. And now what we're going to do is do that for each var, well, let's name it again, value in source items. So this is going to be kind of funny. I'm going to loop through the source items now, and I'm going to see if, you know, our filtered items are in there. So if not filtered items dot contains value, then what I'm going to say is my items dot remove value. So again, this can be complex objects too. So you want to, you know, this is just a flat one, but here you can also say, maybe this is a complex object right here, and you can here dive into some property of your complex object. so you can filter on values in your property or whatnot. Again, if this is, you know, I'm talking nonsense and you can't follow, let me know in the comments and I'll do a follow-up video with the complex objects. But I hope you can figure that out and see it as a nice exercise for yourself. So I'm going to remove this one, and else if not my items dot contains value, then of course I want to add it. My items dot add a value. So what is happening here? We're looping through the source items and we're going to see first if the filtered items not contains value. Then we know we have to remove it from my items. We don't have to check if it's in there, yes or no. It will just remove it if it's in there. If it's not in there, it will just skip over it. And else we're going to say, because you know this can never be true both. So else if are my items, so the actual thing that we're showing on screen, contains value. If it doesn't contain it, then we're going to add it because you know we want to actually add it in there. So let's just stop and run our code and see how this all works at runtime. And then we're going to check if we actually need this little bit right here. So it's restarting, it's coming up, and we should see our little list. There we go. Subscribe, YouTube channel, Monkeys, Gerald. And whenever I start typing here now, you can see whenever I start typing my name, it just filters nicely to Gerald. And when I clear this thing, then they're all coming back. So that is pretty cool, right? And now why I added the two subscribe things here. So when I do sub, you can also see it does these both things. And this time I'm going to click cancel right here. And again, it's all coming back. So that is pretty cool, right? This is how you filter your collection view or your list view or anything that uses a observable collection. Maybe you're using some kind of collection view from a vendor like Syncfusion or Telerik or whatever. It all works the same way. So if we stop this now for a little bit and check if we actually need this code, so I'm going to remove it, start it again, and see if we actually need that extra check, because you know we all hate extra code that doesn't do anything. So let's see if we actually need it. So I'm going to do whoops, Gerald, there we go. And you see the autocorrect here is throwing me off. Oh, you can see whenever that was my first statement. So because I'm making this a string empty here, whenever it's null, empty or white space, it automatically resolves this to true and all of our things are coming back here. So we don't actually need that code. So that is pretty cool. Now you know how to filter your collection view in a Xamarin Forms application. Now there was a couple of things that you have to find out for yourself, how to do this with MVVM, how to do this with complex objects. Again, if you can figure it out, please ask me in the comments below, or I have a Discord server this time around. So ask me for the link, I will add you. I'm trying to keep it a little bit small at this time to first shape it, but you're invited because you have watched it this far to this episode. Ask me for a link, you can be added and you can ask me there directly. So that's pretty cool. Thank you for watching this video. Like it, click that like button, click that subscribe button. If you're new here, then very welcome. I hope you found this video useful. And else I just going to say thank you and see you for the next video. Keep coding.